say glory.
Glory.
Oh, man, I feel the atmosphere is conducive for the Spirit of God to just move in this place.
Amen.
Oh, I feel his presence this morning. Did you feel it in praise and worship?
Amen.
Oh, come on, somebody. I felt his presence this morning. And I think the atmosphere is conducive for the Holy Spirit to do something great in this place.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Y'all know our theme this month is All In For God. And as we continue with our sermon series that we started last week, the five marks of discipleship, last week we talked about knowledge of the word, which was session one. This week we're going to begin session two as we talk about obedience to the word. The five marks of discipleship. Last week we talked about, sermon one was called Knowledge of the Word. This is where someone, I consider them knowledge seekers. At this point, they are lookers. They come into the church. They may have had a relationship with Christ and got disconnected or grew up in the family home, and they're just looking to reconnect and just to kind of fill that void that they've been having. So we call them lookers. This week, we're going to talk about obedience to the word. This is where someone moves from the looker to the listener. The listener, from lookers to listeners. Next week, we're going to talk about involvement in ministry. This is where they go from learners. So they go from lookers to listeners to learners. Session four, we're going to talk about spiritual reproduction. This is where they go to laborers. So they go from lookers to listeners, from learners to laborers. And then last session, which is session five, Christ-likenesses, that's when they go to leaders. So we're looking at how a person goes from a looker to a listener to a learner to a laborer and to the leader. Five marks of discipleship. Are y'all with me this morning? So today is our second session, Sermon 2, and it talks about knowledge of the Word. And you would open your Bibles with me and turn to 2 Corinthians. Chapter 7, verse 15. And if you can, and if you're able, please stand for the reading of the word. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 15, and it says, "And his affections for you is even greater, as he remembered the obedience of you all, how you received him with fear and trembling." Let every head be bowed and every eyes be closed. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, as we stand here before your throne of grace today, giving you all the honor and glory. Father, we ask that you take control of this service. Speak to our hearts so that your word may draw us closer to you, God. Use me as your mouthpiece this morning. Let the wisdom and revelation of your word manifest itself through salvation. For those that don't know you but want to know you, God, Father, continue to give us the courage to stand for what you stand for and fight for what you are against. Now, God, when you're tired, when we're tired, give us strength. Yes. Lord, when we're confused, guide us. Yes. When we're weary, energize us. Yes. When we're burned out, infuse us with the power of the Holy Spirit so that we may have the anointing to do what needs to be done.
Yes.
Now hide me, Vance, behind your cross, O God. Yes. Decrease in me and increase in you, Lord, yes, so that the transformation of the heart may take place.
Yes.
Let us ascend to the upper room, O God, so as you may speak to us all, Father, because your word reigns true then, now, and forever. We give you thanks right now in what you're about to do in this place. We magnify you in the wonderful and the glorious name of Jesus. And the saints said, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Go ahead and give the Lord a hand clap of praise on your way down. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So obedience to the word. You know, sometimes Fortune 500 companies sometimes have what they call staff audits. And a staff audit is designed to analyze who is where and whether they are producing at the level that they ought to be producing at for the position that they occupy. Are y'all with me? This point, the point of this is to make sure that people are in the right place doing the right thing the right way. One of the questions on the floor during the audit is, does each staff member job and productivity contribute contribute to the goal of the company? Well, saints, that's the same answer God wants, the same question that God asks us. The same question God wants answered. How does the life of every Christian contribute to his kingdom? Are you being obedient to his word? Because if so, then the kingdom will be moved forward because of your obedience. Look at your neighbor and say, I got to be obedient. Obedience, by definition, is defined as carrying out the word and the will of another person, especially the will of God. Obedience is a positive, active response to what a person hears. God summons people to active obedience to his revelation. And people that fail to obey God results in judgment. In the Old Testament covenant between God and human beings, obedience was the basis for knowing God's blessing and favor. God's pleasure was not in the sacrifice, but in his obedience. Even in the New Testament, the obedience of Christ stands in contrast to the disobedience of Adam. The disobedience of Adam brought death, but the perfect obedience of Christ brought grace, righteousness, and life. So when people go from knowledge of the word to obedience of the word, they hit that second mark of discipleship. They become listeners. They become listeners. The second mark of discipleship, which means they are beginning to have an understanding of the word and are ready to surrender to it and put its application to work in their life. The Bible says in James chapter 1, verse 22 through 23, it says, but be ye doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves, for it is anyone who hears the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks intensely at his face in the mirror. In other words, hearing the word of God alone without action is self-deception. Just hearing the word is not good enough. It takes some action behind that thing. You got to become a doer of the word. You got to be obedient to his word. Just hearing is not enough. But receiving the results of doing what the word says is where the blessing is. Understand, the only proper response to the word of God is allowing it to take root in one's life. Are y'all with me? The illustration used in verse 23 is this. Holding our life up to God's mirror and our imperfections are revealed to us, common sense says we should do something about them. But to do nothing is foolish. When we know better, we do. Walking in disobedience once the Lord has revealed something to you is just flat out rebellion. Are y'all hearing me? So the very first point I want to make is this. We have to become one with the word. We have to become one with the word. We have to sleep, breathe, eat, walk, study, read, pray, become one with the word. Are y'all hearing me today?
Oh, yeah.
It has to be the authority of our life. Not the world, not secular society, not none of that other stuff, not your job, not your family. The word has to be top shelf.
Amen.
That's the thing that we have to stand under or own.
Yes.
Come on, somebody. You have to become one with the word. In order to live by the word of God, you have to know what the word says. We talked about that last week. You have to know what the word says and have a working understanding of how to apply it in your everyday living. You know, a lot of saints hear the word, but they don't know how to make that an application in their life. You know? That's why I believe, this is just me personally, that's why I believe that, you know, sometimes God sends good people in your path to mentor you, to help you, to guide you, to teach you, to instruct you, to how to make that word become alive in your life, how you can walk that thing out. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Apply that word to our everyday living so that others may see it manifested in your life and that you may be able to teach, to instruct for duplication and all of that. The Bible says in 2 Timothy 2:15, and your Awana gurus know this, study to show thyself approved and unto God, a workman that he needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. As I was looking at this, the thing study to show thyself just kind of stuck with me a little bit. Study to show thyself. Study to show thyself. Study to show thyself. Insinuates that you have to spend some time becoming a student of the word. Are y'all hearing me? Not just coming on Sundays, and that's the only time you open up your Bible. Monday through Saturday, if not every day, hear me, you got to spend some time in the word. Amen. Becoming a student of the word, pondering on the word, meditating on the word, dividing it, seeking it out, looking it up, researching it, diving into it, you know, chewing on it. Chewing on the facts, pastor says sometimes. Sometimes you got to chew on that word. So you can have a good understanding of it. Study to show thyself approved. Not just reading it, but getting wisdom from God through the Holy Spirit as you learn to grow in Scripture. Because as you begin to read Scripture, as you begin to understand it, the Holy Spirit will reveal some things to you. Amen. Oh, yes, he will. Mm-hmm. He will show you stuff about yourself that you did not. Mm-hmm. Come on. He will show you some things. He will teach you some things because the Holy Spirit is the ultimate teacher. Amen. He will teach you some things about you to make you a better you as you mature in Scripture or mature in Christ. We need to have the proper understanding so you can be a good witness unto God because you are his representatives here on earth. One of my dear mentor, pastor, friends always said, you should always be ready to give an account. Always be ready to give an account. For who is your hope for? Are y'all hearing me? The word approved. Study to show thyself approved. If something has been approved, that means it has been tested. You can't approve something that's not been tested. Am I right about it? If it's been approved, it has been tested. Has your life been tested? Have you been approved? Are you continuing to walk this thing out? I know that I am. Sometimes I don't think the testing ever stops it, man. But I continue to walk this thing out. Being approved is what remains after what has been tested. Study to show thyself approved is what remains after you have been tested. Once you have been tested by living the word, when you have been proven, never, never, ever, ever be embarrassed of living by the word and your knowledge of the word. Society will try to tell you, oh, you're too churchy. You're just a church boy.
Yeah, I am.
You're just a Jesus fanatic.
Yeah, I am.
You just take that Jesus thing way too far.
Yeah, I do.
Because I'm in love with everything about Jesus. Everything about Jesus. The good, the bad, the ugly, the indifferent, the comfort, the love, the passion, the compassion, the suffering. I'm in love with everything about Jesus.
Amen.
So call me a Jesus fanatic. I'll write to that. Are y'all hearing me today?
Amen.
Call me a Jesus fanatic. I will write to that. Call me a church boy and put me back. Because I will never be ashamed of the gospel. Never, ever be ashamed of the gospel. Never stop learning. Never stop seeking. Never stop challenging yourself. Never stop walking this thing out. Never stop reading. Never stop studying. Never stop meditating. Never stop memorizing. Study to show thyself approved so that we may rightly dividing the word. rightly dividing the word. Rightly dividing the word. I believe that we all have to have a proper context of scripture when reading it or teaching it so that we may communicate its truth. I think you can't communicate its truth if you don't have a proper context of it.
That's true.
Come on, somebody. Because the word of God is absolute truth. And it defines the nature of scripture. So sometimes, in order to get that understanding, you have to also look into some resources and consult with the Bible to gain that perspective. You know, like commentaries and things like that, research to gain the right perspective. To make sure you understand the context of what it was speaking. So you, when you're getting ready to communicate that truth, you know what you're standing on and you know what you're talking about. Come on. Because there's a lot of different thoughts out there on a lot of different things. But I always say, go back to the Word.
Amen.
Go back to the Word. Don't matter what your great, glorious preacher, Uncle Tommy, backyard barbecue told you. Go back to the Word. Go back to the Word. Because people have a proclivity to take Scripture and twist it to what they think what they want it to be.
Yes.
Are y'all hearing me? Go back to the Word. And you may still may not get it. That's when I do is call in a buddy and say, hey man, let's look at this and dig into it together. Get a different perspective. Try to find out what's going on with it. Nothing wrong with that. Amen?
Amen.
Go back to the Word. Study to show thyself approved, rightly dividing the Word. Why are you talking about this? And you're talking about obedience. Because we gotta be obedient to reading the Word. We gotta be obedient to studying the Word. We have to be obedient to learning and growing in the Word.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit also reveals things to you based on where you are in life. I'm sure this happened more than just me. You can read something in a text that you read 5 years ago and read it today and get a different perspective or a deeper understanding of it because you're at a different place in your life. Are y'all hearing me? So the Holy Spirit reveals things to you based on where you are. There's things I'll be reading. Now I get it. Get it? Gotta come. You know? So you have to be truly open to the Spirit of God as your teacher and your guide, ensuring that you don't have anything from hindering the Spirit from moving in your life. No distractions. No distractions. Sometimes we distract ourselves. We put things before the Word, before our relationship with Christ, before serving, before honoring God, before being obedient. Sometimes you got to get rid of distractions and go into that quiet place. Spend some time with the Lord. Understand the Word of God is a lighthouse of truth in the darkness of falsehood. So we have to handle it correctly with utmost respect because failing to do so can lead to divine judgment. Have you ever been in a place where it seems like you're the only light in that place? It's just so dark around you. Conversations are dark, the atmosphere is dark, the people are, you know, they're cloudy. And you're like, Lord, give me strength to go in this place today. Let me represent you. Somebody's always watching. You may be the only light in that dark place that somebody sees.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
You got to keep fighting the good fight. We got to keep growing. We got to keep learning. We got to keep maturing. We got to keep progressing. Which brings me to my second point. We have to look at the Word through Jesus. We have to look at the Word through Jesus. The Bible says in James 1:1, in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. Jesus was living walking, Jesus was the living, walking word. So I think we have to pay very close attention to the sayings of Jesus and the way he lived his life. After all, he embodied all the treasures of divine wisdom and the collective thoughts of God.
Yes, amen.
Think about that. That's pretty awesome.
Yes.
When you think about it. I know it sounds kind of melancholy, but when you think about it, that's pretty awesome. Embody all the treasures of divine wisdom. Wisdom. And the collective thoughts of God. Ain't that what we're trying to do, is get more Christ-like? To try to walk with Christ? Who better? Life, whose life better to look at than Jesus?
Amen.
Man. So when we look at his teachings and his principles, we need to be trying to live as close to a Christ-like life as possible. With understanding that the word of the living God is your point of connection for intimacy with the Lord. The word will draw you in. It don't need no help. But it can help us out a lot. I said that last week, right? It don't need no help, but it can sure help us out a lot. The word will draw you in. It's one of those things, you know, how many of you, and I want y'all to be honest, when you first start reading the word, you're like, oh man, I really don't want to read my Bible. Pick it up anyway, and you start reading a little bit, and you put it down, and the next day, oh man, dang, it's that time again, you know. You pick up your Bible, you read a few chapters, and you put it down, and then the third day, you pick it up, and you get ready to read, and the phone rings, you know. Go eat dinner or something like that happens, and you end up reading late, and you're really tired, and you really don't feel like reading anyway, you read it. Then that fourth day, you pick it up again, and you can't stop reading it for some reason. You're reading it, and something begins to happen. You, next thing you know, it's an hour and a half, and you don't read it out. And then that fifth day, you get home, and you're excited about picking up where you left off, and you pick up that word again, and you're starting to read it, and next thing you know, you're sitting there, and the wife and the husband say, hey, are you going to eat dinner? And 2.5 hours have passed, and you're still reading the word. The word will draw you in. It will draw you in. If you love it, it will love you.
Amen.
It's going to love you anyway, but if you love it, it will love you.
Amen.
Are you hearing me?
Come on.
Some of us, that's the only quiet time we get. Am I right? With all the noise going on around us and the chaos, I call it white noise, all the noise going on around us and other things happening in our life, we say, oh man, it's quiet. Let me bring my Bible out. Let me get that 15, 20 minutes in, right?
Mm-hmm.
In a doctor's office sometimes, right? The word will draw you in. In the beginning was the word, which refers to the timeless eternity of God, because the word is timeless. It was already there in the beginning. It was there before the creation of time. It was there before the creation of time. I say all the time, God is not inside of time, but time is inside of God.
Amen.
Know that the old Jewish rabbis often referred to God in his more personal terms as the word. In the beginning was the word. So he was there before the creation of time. Then the scripture says, and the word was with God. And the word was with God. This fact suggests a face-to-face relationship, indicating a personal relationship, but also implies equal status with the Father. Then John says, and the word was God. This is a declaration of Christ's deity. The word was God. This is a brilliant statement that John makes here in this verse. Do y'all see it? Because here in this verse, because it helps support the basic foundation of the Trinity. That's what it does. Brilliant, brilliant the way he put that together. And we ain't gonna get into the Trinity. That's a whole other sermon. Gotta preach by myself. Amen. You know, looking at the word through the life of Jesus, being as we grow closer to him and become more like his Christ, more like his likeness, we begin to pick up some of his character traits. Oh, I want to look like my daddy. How many of y'all want to look like your dad? I want to look like my daddy. We become more like him. We pick up some of his attributes. Studying his life is like a roadmap. You know? I want to look like Jesus.
Amen.
I want to have his character and his integrity, his passion and compassion. You do that by starving your flesh, which is the hardest thing to do. You know, I think Paul said it best. He said, the things that I don't want to do, I do. Things that I do want to do, don't need to do. Things I don't want to do, I do. The things I do need to do, I don't. You know? We've got to begin to be obedient in this area of carrying our cross. Obedience in the area of starving our flesh, crucifying our flesh daily, walking with Christ. What do I mean by that? I'm glad y'all asked. This is what I mean by that. You know, the Lord reveals something to you. Okay? It's going to make you a better person, better human being, all that good stuff. But yet, the world tells you to do this. And you say, I know I should be doing this, but this show feel good. Mm-hmm. You know? I know I shouldn't. I done had 2 pieces of chocolate cake. I know I don't need that 3rd piece. But it's okay. Well, that's a small thing, but guess what that falls up underneath? Self-control. Am I right about it? Oh, I struggle with this thing daily. I love to eat, so I struggle with this thing daily. So I'm just talking about taking pieces from my life. You know? But we got to be obedient to starving that thing and doing what we know is right. Am I right about it? Does that make sense? And it's the small things that we have to be obedient in. The big things, we see those coming, so we can fend those off. But it's those small little things, you know? Well, I could watch my favorite TV show, you know, or I can read. I think I'm going to watch Love and Hip Hop. Come on, somebody. Okay. Act like y'all don't know what I'm talking about if y'all want to. But I'm going to read my word. Am I right? Those small things, you know? You know, I should be serving in, you know, this ministry over here, but I ain't got time. I got to do this, I got to do that, you know. Well, Brother so-and-so said such-and-such, that's why I ain't going. Come on. See, y'all don't want to be one, huh? I don't know why she talked to me like that. I ain't got to put up with that. And then we allow someone else to stop us from serving God.
Come on.
You're not serving that person. You're supposed to be serving God.
That's right.
Do it unto the Lord.
Yes.
You got to be obedient even when it doesn't feel like it. Even when you don't want to, you got to walk the right way.
Amen.
And sometimes that's hard. He never said it was going to be easy. Sometimes it's hard to love Uncle Pookie when he's getting on your last nerve. But you got to love him anyhow because you got to be obedient to the word. You're not serving that person. We need to get that through our mind. It's not that person that you're serving. It's the Lord.
Amen.
And so when you don't show up, when you're supposed to be there, you're not hurting him. But come on. You're not hurting that person. You're not in rebellion against that person. You're in rebellion against the Lord. Okay, so I'll hit you on the way home. I want to be like my daddy. I want to walk like Christ. Walk out that plan of salvation for your life is what the old saints used to say. My mom used to say, walk it out, boy. Walk it out. Looking at Christ's life teaches us how we should respond to certain situations. He gives us a model of the type of temperament we should have. We can't let everything get to us. We got to look at the bigger picture. Control. Discipline, meekness. Oh, meekness is not weak. The devil is a lie. Sometimes it's strong. You got to be strong in order to be quiet. Okay, how many times you said, Lord, please don't let me say what I want to say? It takes strength to close that mouth sometimes.
Yes.
Can I get an amen, ladies?
Yes.
Right? It takes strength to be quiet sometimes. So to walk in humbleness, To walk in meekness is not a sign of weakness. I think it's a sign of strength because Jesus walked in humbleness. Jesus walked in meekness. And I'm team Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
So if it was strength for him, my God, it's going to be strength for me. But I will tell a person, don't let this suit fool you. Glory be to God. The right temperament. James says in James verse 1:22, but be ye doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving our own selves. My third point. We got to be willing to apply the word. We got to be willing to apply the word. We not only need to hear the word, but put them into action. Jesus tells us out of his own mouth, in Matthew 7, 24 through 28. 24, he says this. Therefore, whosoever hear these sayings of mine and do them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. Jesus is telling us here, we need to apply his teachings to our everyday life. They should be the foundation upon every decision that we make. I'm going to use the word built. When I think of a builder, you know, I used the example earlier in the first service that I've been working with Wayne on a project, and I'm kind of getting an understanding of a builder or a carpenter and how they work. But when I think of a builder, I think of someone who has a plan for what he's manufacturing. He has inventoried his materials. He has a plan. He has inventoried his materials. He has drafted out an end result, created a blueprint, measured it again and again and again, calculated the labor involved, and has weighed the cost. This is how we should measure our decisions against the word of God.
Amen. Amen.
This is how we should measure them. Then he goes on to say, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and they beat upon that house. And it failed not, for it was founded upon a rock.
Amen.
When you make your choices based on the word of the Lord, it doesn't matter what kind of turbulence you're going to encounter getting to your destiny. Because you have weighed the cost and have decided to follow the teachings of Jesus Christ, our Lord. And he will keep you because he's considered you faithful and trustworthy. It doesn't matter that the storms of the enemy are coming. Because they're going to come anyway. But Jesus will keep you. He will keep you in that relationship falling apart. He will keep you because he has considered you trustworthy once you begin to follow him. Verse 26 says, and everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and do them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which has built his house upon sand. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell. And great was the fall on it. Let's stop right there. It says, great of the fall on it. I mean, it just didn't fall down. It had a great fall. Oh, glory be to God. It had a great fall. That means something got broken on the way down. A great fall, not just a fall. Let me make that thing plain. You could destroy your family on the way down. You could hurt the people that you love on the way down. It's a great fall, he said. You notice how when the men of God fall from grace, it's not just, well, this person did this, repent and move it on. No, it's all on TV, CNN, TBN, EFN, everywhere. It's everywhere. Because it's a great fall. It hurts. It's a hard fall. It's the difference from falling from the first floor or the 10th floor. It's a hard fall. And when you fall from the 10th floor, oh, you're going to break something going down.
Yeah.
You're going to destroy something. When you don't build your house on Jesus, you can build it on what the world says if you want to. But the text says it was a great fall. And usually, you know what happens? Usually we hurt the people around us. That's when we get hurt the most. It's the truth anyhow. The husband, the children, the wives, we hurt the people around us. They're the ones that suffer because of our shenanigans. It's grateful. It hurts. It destroys something. It broke something on the way down. And guess what? Sometimes you can even bring two or three folk down with you. You fall and you grab it on somebody. We all know somebody that was just casualties of war. They was just in the wrong place at the right time. Somebody grabbed them on the way down. Great fall. And it came to pass when Jesus had ended these sayings, the people were astonished at his doctrine. Jesus is telling us here what to build our life on, and that's him. Anything else that you choose to build upon will not last when the storms of life come, and they will. If your life is not built on Jesus being the foundation, it will be washed away. You can't build it on your own ability, because only the ability of God. You can't build it on the premise of making money, because it all belongs to God. You can't build it on acquiring possessions thinking that they will make you happy, because true joy comes from the Lord. You can't build it on your life around you with friends and relationships with people, because they will leave you and they will let you down. But the God who loves you, the God who saves you, the God who cares about you, he said, I will never leave you nor forsake you.
Amen.
You got to build this thing on Jesus Christ. Build your life on Christ. This is just not a weekend project. Christ is the only thing strong enough to shoulder us in the issues of the world.
Amen.
As I come to a close, I say this. His shoulders is broad enough to carry the sins of the world. There's not a man alive who can carry that.
Amen.
But Christ, if he can carry the sins of the world, he's sure enough to carry vast little issues.
Amen.
Am I right about it? Y'all little, matter of fact, he can put all of our issues in the backpack and carry them together. And it's only in one pocket. Build your life on Christ. Build it on Christ. Build it on Christ. His shoulders are strong enough, broad enough, and big enough. You know, I love the saying, I love every time I hear it, almost brings me to tears, when they say, we don't know the breadth and the depth of his love. My God. I can't even wrap my mind around that.
Mm-hmm.
How can a person contain, have the capacity to contain so much love that we can't even, in a society in which we live in, we can't even know the breadth and the depth of it. Imagine if that much love dwelled in you or in us. My goodness. My goodness. That's, maybe I'm just crazy, but that's to me. That much love. And y'all know how I feel about love. I say it all the time. Love conquers all. He loved us when we didn't even know how to love ourselves. When we was about to lose our mind and our life was chaotic. I loved us. And I know we got husbands and wives that love us unconditionally, but their love is not even a drop in the bucket to the love that Christ has for you. It's not even a mustard seed compared to the love that he has for us. The breadth and the depth of his love. We can't even measure that. My God, I'm going to love like that. And they wonder, why am I in love with Jesus? My God, how can you not be? When he loves like that, when his love is not judgment, it's not quid pro quo. It's not you got to do this or you got to do that. Even when we don't think we're worthy of ourselves.
Amen.
He loves us.
Amen.
I'm so glad.
He loves us.
Amen.
To the point that he became flesh. To the point God gave his only son. His bloodline. Every man wants a son. And when you're willing to give up your bloodline for the sake of others,
mm-hmm.
my God, that's a powerful kind of love.
Amen.
My God. I can't even imagine that. I can't even imagine that. But I want to love like that. I want to move to loving like that. I want to love not just my wife, but everybody in my circle like that.
Yes.
But I can love everybody like that. Yes, even Uncle Pookie. Like that. Because you know what it was? It wasn't about him.
That's right.
It wasn't about him. It wasn't, I can't get over this.
Right.
Yeah, but I don't like that. Ah.
Yeah, but they did this.
Yeah, I hear you. But you're not responsible for what they did.
That's right.
We're responsible for what we did.
Amen.
That's right.
Come on. We're not responsible for what they did, but we are responsible for what we did.
Amen.
Love, the most powerful is an ingredient that you can have. How do I know that's true? Because Jesus said it. No greater love for a brother to lay down his life for another. Serving, sacrifice, obedience, all that encompasses love. You do that for folk that you love. Can y'all hear me? I know I'm beating this thing in the wall, but you got to get this thing. Because we let too many small things interfere when we're trying to love God's people.
Amen.
That's right.
Come on.
We put a TV show over loving God's people.
Yes.
A sport, all this over loving and serving God's people.
Amen.
That's not what the Bible says. Love. Even when you don't feel like it. Look, saints, I know none of us is perfect. I know that. And that we all make mistakes. But we don't have to continue to make the same ones. Grace allows us to start anew. Some of you done tried everything that there is to try. Nothing has worked. And you wonder why you haven't got your breakthrough yet. Why it hasn't been your season. You can't seem to move forward to take the next step. Nothing you have tried has made you feel complete. See, the world is full of incomplete people. That's why we need to be affiliated with things to make us feel complete.
Right.
Whether it's games, or jobs, relationships, we find our identity in those things because we're incomplete. But get this thing. There's an emptiness, a void that you've been trying to fill. You know, people can be in a room full of people and still be alone. You can be in a room with 1,000 folks and still feel alone. Maybe I'm just preaching to myself. Because there's an emptiness. There's a void. There's people in that same room that want to love you, want to show you that they love you, want to give you that gift of love, but you're so isolated that you don't even know how to receive it. They want to love you and show you that love, but you don't know how to receive that love. I was there. Christ can change all of that. He can change all of that. All of that. He can make you whole.
Amen.
He can make you whole again.
Yeah. Amen.
If you just give in and surrender to his love and his obedience, I declare that he will make you whole.
Yes. Come on.
Why is that important? Because I want to love like that.
Amen.
I want to love like that so I can be loved like that. You better get this.
Yes.
I want to love like that so I can be loved like that.
Yes, come on.
Love like that. So you can be loved like that. I need to stop fighting, talk about the love of Christ all day long because I'm in love with everything about Jesus.
Amen. Yeah. Amen.
Let us stand as sing. I came here to tell someone today, you've tried everything else that there is to try.